Thank you, everyone, for finding time to attend today's discussion. So my name is Christopher Maronga, and I'm going to take you through the discussion of chapter 7, chapter 9. I think Lucy mentioned something about the chapters having different levels and the title. So maybe, yeah, I think it's chapter 9, uploads on and downloads with regards to the Shiny app. Okay.
Is it possible for you to enlarge it? It looks a bit, yeah.
That's better?
Yes.
Fantastic, thank you. Okay. So yeah, so the objectives for the discussion today is at least by the end of the discussion, we'll have reviewed on how to upload and download a file, add that functionality into the Shiny app, and look at the structure of the UI component and as well as the server component with regards to uploading and downloading a file into and out of Shiny. So we'll also review on how the two components fit together to be able to achieve the functionality of downloading or uploading a file or a data into or out of Shiny. Okay, I've put together a few examples you're going to share, both the one from the book and as well as some test examples that I was playing around with. Okay. So file uploads. So it's possible to upload a file into Shiny, and the function that handles that is the file input, and of course the two arguments, ID and label, as any other input function in Shiny. So and the other arguments for multiple, if you want to upload multiple files, and also you can specify accept, that is what extension you allow your users to upload. So I think this serves a purpose of probably validating on the kind of uploads that you accept. So that's on the server, on the user interface side. On the server end, we actually working with the still the output from the file input, and it's a special type of output, which is actually a data frame with a structure that you're going to review. So I think I'll just go through the columns contain that particular object, and we are going to just see examples of that. So yeah, so the first column is the name. I think this is the name of the file, the name of the file that you're uploading on the computer, the size of the file, maximum 5 MB, the type, either it's a CSV or an XLSX, and the data path. So this is the temporary folder. Sorry, it's temporary path to a temporary folder where your file is uploaded in the server before you can be able to read it. So let's go and just look at the code and example. So this is a example code. So I'm just going to switch to my Shiny and. So maybe I could just to review the structure. So on the user interface, post the file input, so you specify the ID, post the button label, and whether you want to whether you are functional accept multiple uploads or not, and so I'm going to run this and try to upload a file and see how that comes out. So this serves as a preamble to just, let me just pick a sample file from my. Yeah, it's a large one. Let me use this. Yeah, so you can see the contents of input, the content of this file input, which is the upload that we are accessing using input and dollar sign upload, is basically a data frame, which has this column. So the name, the size, the type, and the data path. And as we are going to see in the next example, I think the data path is what now we will use to be able to handle the actual reading of the data into the shiny and be able to even display the output. So yeah, so it's just a structure, and now we are going to run this app, just review the code and run the actual app that accepts a file. So as you can see, I added something here, let me just move it. So the user interface, we are using the file input to be able to upload a file, and we are specifying the acceptable extensions, either CSV or a tab separated file, and of course the placeholder to be able to just communicate to the user. On the server end, so one thing to note is that when the app starts this particular content for the input upload, which is the content for the file input, is initialized to null. So therefore, we use rec to actually be able to make sure that whatever happens below this requires a file to be uploaded. So, and on line 24 here, so you can see I think this code basically extracts the file extension from the name column of the data frame that we saved the results from input upload that has the four columns. So one of the columns, the name, will contain the file extension. So use this function to actually extract the file extension. So then the switch argument here is basically giving us the flexibility to be able to, based on the file extension, based on the file extension that of the file that you have uploaded, to use the appropriate function to read. So as you can see, the input $upload $datapath, which is one of the columns of the input upload output, which is the data frame, it's the one containing the path, the actual path to the file. So you can see it's being fed to the function vroom as any path, or as you do from your local computer. And finally, validate. I think this to make sure that any file extension outside these two specified is rejected by an error. So, and finally, here we are just finding the, like, after the data has been uploaded, which is being captured in this section, and now we just look at the first a couple of rows. So I'm just going to run this and see. Okay, so opening my browser, I'm going to upload a CSV file. Pick a random one from my downloads. And you can see, so now if you alter that, you get 10 rows and that. So, and yeah, basically that's how you can upload a file, a CSV, into a shiny using this implementation of the user interface and the server end. I don't know if there's any comment or question.
No, I think, thank you. I have a comment.
Yes.
Okay, I think in the previous slide you were saying in the server, the maximum, the size in which the app can take is 5 megabytes. So in this case, what about in case we have a file that is above, maybe just say 200 megabytes, how do we go about that?
So there's a function you can use to basically increase that. I just want to check on the notes. You can increase the so you can use this function to actually alter the amount, the size of the file that can be accepted during upload. So yes, that's basically options, and use that and specify the maximum size. I hope that's answered.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, thank you. So I had another app, a similar one, which I was basically trying to play around with the ideas of downloading an app from, uploading a file. And I basically added another extension because the example from the book basically accepts CSV and tab delimited. So just to show the idea that the most important thing is the input $upload $data path, which gives you the path and extension to the file that you are uploading from a temporary directory. So then you provide the appropriate read function. So for instance, here I'm using readexl, and if I upload a CSV, an XLS file, it would probably be read correctly, as opposed to if I had used the previous example, which did not have this particular, this line of code, line 30 here. So I'm going to just test that with an XLS file. You can basically add, I'm having trouble with sharing my multiple screens. Bear with me, please. Let me try and fix that. Okay. Great. So I'll just go and try and upload as an XLS file. Let me try this one. It can be read successfully because of the line that I added down here. So you can even, I think you can read various extension, maybe a DTF file, a stata file. Just you need to have this in place and the correct read function for that particular extension that you want to read. So I found this very useful. So yeah, I'll move forward. Any question, clarification?
I have a question.
Yes.
So I see if you're uploading the Excel file, the XLS file, yes, you use the r_XLS function.
Yes, let me just open it.
But then I realized on the notes for the CSV and the text file, we're using the Vroom.
Yeah.
Okay, can you use like a function like read_CSV to do that in place of that? Or it has to be particularly the Vroom function?
You can use any function to read. So you know the usual way you read a data set. For instance, I will probably replace this with say read_CSV and it will just work. So maybe you can just test that and see. So I'll just do that, and instead of now using Vroom, I'll say maybe I'll use read_CSV. So it will work. It's just that now I will think I'll have to remove this. I don't know whether read_CSV accepts that argument. So you can test and see. But yeah, so to answer your question is that you can use the usual function that you are used to. So for reading, just you need to know which extension it accepts. And I think for the tab delimited as well, I don't have a tab delimited file on my computer, but you can use read.table. You're familiar with that. And so you can use that as well in place of Vroom. Okay. Okay, that's all about file uploading, and I don't know if there's any comment or any question before I could. I added some comment down here that in uploading the data, the input upload data path, which is accessed from the server, is of focus since it contains the path that can be supplied to the to an appropriate function for reading the data to achieve the uploading goal. So yeah, what that simply means is just what I have explained, that you need just keep an eye on this bit of input upload, upload being the ID for your file input, and of course, subsetting, or rather accessing the data path. So because that is what you supply your favorite read function, and you'll be able to achieve the same goal to of reading data into, rather allowing that, you to upload that data in the form of reading it from your temporary folder in the shiny. Okay. Fantastic. So yeah, I'll move to downloads. So yeah, so I know so we can also include, I mean, download buttons in our Shiny app. And so for file downloads, we use the download button, which has definitely those two arguments, the ID and the label. So ID being the unique identifier for that particular button, and the label for maybe what the button does, and or you can use the download link. So there are other arguments you can check and customize the button. That's on the user interface end, but on the server end, how we handle the download button is different from the usual like function. So we, if you take note, is that in the server end, we are using download handler, but we are not pairing it with any render function. So it's not being paired with any render function. It's a special kind of handling. So it's download button and download handler. And in the download handler, we have two components. So you have the file name, which is a function that has no argument. And the function basically returns the name of the file, how you download it to your computer with the relevant file extensions. So you're going to check on. And the other function is the content. So the content has one argument file. And basically this part contains, as you can see, it contains the, I'll say in quote, the instructions on how you should save or you should download that, rather how you are going to achieve the download, as well as I think the paths to where that the file will be saved. So I'm just going to switch and see an example on how we can download data and run that app and review a few of the components. Okay, so I have this this app here. Okay, so the user interface. I've picked this app. This is the app from the book, which displays the list of datasets from the package datasets, and outputting a table or a few rows of the dataset of choice. So what happens in the user end is that I am specifying the download button here, and this is the ID and this is the label. So this is what will appear on the button. Then on the server, I'm handling this download. Okay, sorry, the download button is being handled by the download handler. So you can see there is no, sort of like the usual render functions, it's a download handler. So inside that function, we have two other functions, file name and content. So the file name is a function without an argument, and it contains the name of the file with the appropriate extension. And on the content end, as you can see, it's the instruction. So it's just specifying you're going to how Shiny is to handle the saving part. So it's going to handle using Vroom write, and definitely provide the file which it's picked from this particular, segment. So I'm going to run this and see how that goes. So if I choose any appropriate data frame, and I say download, so you see I get a tab separated file in my disk here. Yeah, and you can open and you can view it. And yeah, so you will have downloaded all the dataset from the app. So I just wanted to also mention that I played around with this particular example where I have a different another extension of this app where now probably it allows you to maybe specify the extension that you want to download. If you don't want to download a tab delimited, you can download either of these XLS or CSV. So how that is being handled within the Shiny is that on the UI, I have used a sidebar layout with a sidebar panel specifying the data set selection and the radio buttons for what format, with the choices being this. So how that is being handled in the server is by using switch. So in the sense that you using the choices from the input data format, this one here, and pasting the name of the dataset together with the extension. So based on whatever extension you select. So if you select CSV, so it will be file named of CSV and so forth. And the rest of the code is just the same because it's using Vroom to write as well as switch function here to be able to give the appropriate instruction based on the extension. So on the content part. So I'm going to try and download a CSV of maybe that. So I need to open that on the Shiny. So I'll choose that and select the format and download. So you end up with a CSV format. If you are to do an XLS download, you end up with an XLS format and a tab delimiter. So that's how you can add a little bit of functionality to the app to be able to give you a flexibility to be able to specify a different format that maybe you're working with. Yeah, so any comment, question? Okay, so we switch to the notes. So this very nice diagram, I think gives quite a detailed a summary of logic how it happens in the app. So the file inputs enables you to upload. So the file input functionality enables you to upload the data and as well as enable the Shiny app to access the data that you've uploaded into it. So after that, then of course, you'll explore the data if you are doing an analysis or you are doing a bit of processing within the app, that will happen. And finally, the download button gives you as the user, or rather gives the user whatever ability they can have to download particular results, whether an image. I think you can also do the same for a plot. You can download a plot as the same approach that we have downloaded the data. I didn't manage to produce that, but yeah, I think I'm sure it's possible to download a plot, just specify different instructions. So then after that, of course, having specified the file extension, the type of file you're downloading, you can be able to use download handler with those two functions in it to be able to download the appropriate file, or rather the appropriate file format for your use. Yeah. So I would think plots, I mean, plot, images or other plots, ggplot outputs are most commonly downloaded, but I think, the implementation is pretty much the same, I would think, other than the fact that you need to do a little bit of setting up the image that is being produced. Yeah, I didn't manage, it was a bit complex for me. So I don't know, maybe I'll continue playing around. And if I get it, I'll be able to share and see how that goes. Okay, so any comment on that? Okay, so finally, on the downloading part, so it's the downloading of reports. So sometimes, okay. So other than downloading data, I think it's also possible to download a report being rendered by another Markdown. So just going to review this example vis-a-vis versus this particular diagram here, and just see if we can have further comments. So yeah. Now with our Markdown, If I may, the working directory is not writable. Maybe if you are loading this, maybe even into shinyapps.io, or you are hosting it anywhere, somewhere. So for the rendering of a report, or rather downloading a report, you need to first of all copy that report into a temporary folder within the server, and this is what this code does. So file.copy, so copying report rmd, which is this one, into some temporary folder that has been created there, and overwrite it. Maybe you're doing it for the second time. I think I should have used this one instead, because I think this was a bit simpler, because this was something else, the one that's down here. So then we still use the same buttons, download button, and on the user UI end, and we use download handler to handle the downloading bit on the server end. So what happens here now is that the file name, I think I'll have to change that. So this is the file, this is the name of the report, the resultant name of the report. But if you notice here is that I think it's not now a function, but simply supplied a string specifying the name. Then the content here is specifying part of the parameters you are passing to the R Markdown. If you're familiar with the parameterized report, and post the notification here to just to talk to us about the progress, whether the report is being rendered or not. So the actual rendering is done here. And because I changed these, I need to probably be able to just leave it at that for now. And probably maybe in the next example, you might see how that is different. So if I run that, and if I hit generate report, I get this nice report. So maybe I should show you how that report looks like. The R Markdown itself is here. So what we have, this is what we have just rendered, and And in the meal header, you specify the include the params bit, which will accept parameters that you pass to it from the shiny app. So so one other thing I also learned is that so whenever you are doing this kind of implementation in Shiny, for example, you are implementing a downloading of a report. So the report renders on the current session, the active session, and as we know, so long as the Shiny app is running, the session is inactive. So you cannot run anything. You cannot really do anything. If you try to do any R process, it won't go through. So this kind of process also suffers the same because if you are outputting say multiple reports, you might be able to only download the first report, so you won't be able to download the second one, because if you try to render the second one, the session will always be active, so you won't be able to render that report. So you only render the first report, and this is the suggestion that the author gave, that so for you to be able to bypass that kind of problem is render the report from a clean session, a different session from the session that Shiny is running on. So, and this is the implementation down here using this package called R. So just to recap, using this implementation as it is, if you host this app, and if this app you are using this app to download multiple plots, you might not be lucky to download more than one plot, more than one report, because once you hit run, once the app starts, it will enable you to generate the single first report, but the subsequent one, because the session is busy, you'll not be able to render the subsequent report. But if you use this implementation down here, so maybe you can just review this implementation, whereby you create a function here to render your report. Then instead of now rendering directly like this, I'll do this. Instead of doing rendering directly like this, you use this package called R, so that it runs on a different session from the session that Shiny is active on. So that way you are able to independently download independently download more than one report, or rather subsequent reports, without any trouble, as opposed to the previous implementation, which will not allow you to download any further report after the first one, because the Shiny session will be easy. So I had an example demonstrating that, and I think that will be my last example to review, and see if we can be able to get the meaning, like the just understand the difference between this having your code this way, and as well as the previous one. So let me just stop this and have this one here up. Okay, so on sale. So I'm using the same RMD report. So suppose you are doing some weekly report and you're downloading multiple reports, and you can do that. And for this one, what I've done as well is I've included some small extension to it. So maybe you want to download a different format of report. So the previous one, we download an HTML report. And that's because if you look at the code, for the basic one. So under the file name, it was report.test.html. So we are already cast the stone. We have said we want an HTML report, but you can always want a different format. So if your report supports multiple formats, you can as well do something like this. So let's look at the code, and maybe you can try and download. So you can download a PDF report from the same R Markdown. So you see, if I go back and try to download another one, I'll do a HTML. I'm getting a weekly report for HTML, and I can as well as do a Word document. So you can have same reports, different formats from the same R Markdown. So one thing to note here is that the parameters that have been passed to the report. This one here. So just to note the change that you're actually using. How many rows? So maybe I'll just go back to the code. So and look at the report. So the report, what the report is doing is basically taking the diamonds data set. It samples randomly. The number of rows specified in your shiny app here. If it's 50, it's 100. Then it goes ahead and does a table and a plot, a box plot. So you can just keep note if that's changing. If you change the slider. So now the code for the app. So first, just to create a radio button here. So for specific formats that you want to download. So I'm choosing PDF, HTML, and Word document, but my default is PDF. So then this is the same, download button, the same. So in the download handler, something changes a little bit. So in the file name, which should contain the actual file and file name and extension of the report. So it's a combination of some static string here, which is weekly report, and based on the user selection of either PDF, HTML, and Word document, an appropriate extension is put in front of the weekly report to be able to have either weekly report.pdf, .html, .docs, as opposed to just a single file extension. Then on the render end, you use this function. So this function from still part of the R Markdown. So there's this function PDF underscore document. So this is passed to the report to be able to detect whichever extension that you are really specifying. So, and again, you're using switch. So switch, I don't know if you're familiar with switch, but it's more of, if else, I'll say for lack of a better word. So if the user selects a PDF, then this function will kick in and a PDF document will be rendered. If they select a HTML, that will happen and so forth. And you can include more formats to that. So I just picked those three and I found it very, very interesting because you can be able to get multiple reports from it. So I can run that again and let's see if it meets the expectation. So PDF, once more. Yeah, so if I go back and try to maybe do 100 rows and download. I don't know whether it updated. I'm not sure. But yeah, so. Maybe not. But yeah, so any question with the standard code? Any comment?
Christopher, I was going to go back to your previous example regarding the comment of the shiny session with a single browser interacting, and the reason the rendering process, you have to put that on a different service, a different call to the server to compile. What I was trying to allude to is the differences between synchronous and asynchronous calls. And then the other way that you might be able to use that same phrase would be single threading versus multi-threading. So the first thing that you always want to remember is a server by default is going to be read and execute. You have no write ability. So the previous example you had of moving the file from your current server working directory structure and then copying it to a temp area, that temp area is accessible by the outside world. It's the read, write, execute thought process. The call to that explicit file doesn't actually, it's not accessible by the outside world. So therefore the call would error out. It wouldn't complete. You have to move to that temp area to make it accessible from the user's ability to download. The differences between synchronous and asynchronous is that threading component of, I have an active shiny session that my browser is connected to that server with. If I download, I have to request a different function, a different application, different process ID outside of that shiny session to render the markdown and then make that available pass it back into that single thread to download it. So your comments were 100% spot on. I'm only clarifying exactly what the intent of that single shiny session comment was. You're accessing asynchronous or multi-threading. You're having the server, you're requesting a different session to complete that particular rendering function. So
thank you thank you for the clarification. So yeah, I really enjoyed going through this chapter. It was a simple short yet very exciting chapter, and I really learned a lot of stuff. I'm not sure, maybe just to put through to the audience. So it seems like for the report, it's quite straightforward to do this kind of implementation to copy to the temp folder, which can be accessed to the outside world. I was wondering, what if I have a report that I have these other components? For instance, I have a full-grown report whereby I'm having logos on the cover page. I'm exporting those kind of external images. So like I have a logo, a few logos, a few things I'm putting. So I didn't really figure out how that can be implemented. I tried to do the copy, file copy thing, but it wasn't. So I don't know how I can handle that.
Currently right now, you're just pointing back at a file called report.rmnd. Okay, so that report.rmnd is a static file, it's a static file name called report, and it just happens to be a RMND file. If you were to compile it in another form, what I'm referencing would be almost kind of like a template sort of concept, right? So this RMND file has placeholders of varying points that you would want to populate when you call that render, R markdown render function. And what I'm referring to is line 40. So the static name of report RMD is pointing at that single file, and that's the only thing you're going to get, right? The second example that you have, I think it was the call R function. So here, where you're providing a list input report path, the idea would be that you had a multiple reports. You can generate multiple files, different names, and then either the user can select from those, or you re-render, you overwrite that temp space area that you're downloading from, so that the generated output. What I'm hoping to convey in this nature is that you want to kind of break apart how the function is managing some of this information. So as it's written right now, you're just pointing at a single file called report.rmnd, and whatever contents are inside there, that's what's going to render, right? There's no interaction with it. There's no dynamic changes at all. If you were to change that thought process though, to make that rmnd kind of almost like a template, where inside the rmnd file, you have a bunch of additional references calls that would access other features of that rendering component, references changes, the table changes, et cetera, the naming would still be report rmnd, but it would be more dynamic in what is happening on the server's side of rendering that markdown file. So your logo example, that logo, the template that you have may always have that reference to that logo. If you wanted to change it, if you wanted to modify it, well, okay, so let's go back over to our markdown file real quick and say, currently I have a namespace reference to a single image, and that's it. That's all that's ever going to show up. Let's modify that. Let's change that. Let's try to pass in a variable that says, I want to select a different logo. And maybe that's an option within your Shiny app to say, you know, I want to render it with this business, I want to render it with that business. And so you can change those logos inside the rendering function of the markdown file. It's not going to be the responsibility of Shiny, other than managing the passing of selection from the web browser into the Shiny server that would access the render our markdown render function. I hope I'm making sense as I'm stepping into the logic of what exactly is going on here. So Shiny only has one purpose in your environment. You are calling a second function, a third function, a fourth function, and each one of those you may have to pass information into that function to execute or to accomplish whatever it is you're asking to do. Does that help?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's enlightening. Thanks. Thank you. So, so then I'll finish off this discussion by just reviewing this logic diagram here for how the downloading of reports workflow is. So now here, so the user will provide inputs as expected, and if you're interested in those inputs being part of what informs your report on the RMD, then you pass them as parameters to the render function on the server end. So then, those parameters will be used to inform your report based on the metrics that you are really focusing on. Maybe it's date range, you are reporting from certain date to a certain date in your report, or if it's a weekly report and you want to maybe do some reporting retrospective. So those are the things the params will help you with. And finally, this work of the render markdown to put things together based on the file extension that you specify to be able to give you the report. On other interesting things, tips and tricks, and I think with this what I talked about bullet number two, I just want to highlight bullet number three that if your report, whatever, if your RMD file reports different types of formats. So what I mean by this is that you might have an RMD file that explicitly outputs HTML supported like outputs, for example, tables. So maybe you're using a function, some certain function to output a table that is only supporting the HTML world. So if that's not the case, if your report supports the outputs of your report supports multiple formats, then you can achieve that by, as we saw, by passing these functions to the output format so that you can toggle between whether you want a PDF, a HTML, or a Word document. And I beg to end there. And thank you for listening. Any question, comment? Discussion, Lucy?
Okay, thank you so much, Chris. It was quite nice. Well, I've seen how an example of how you can create, you can download different formats of reports, but to see it in action, it's quite helpful. So thank you. Brian, do you have anything else to add? Or Idele, do you have anything else to add?
No, I don't have anything.
Okay.
No, I'm good. Thank you, Lucy.
Okay. So at the moment, we are heading towards our next discussion will be on chapter 10, that is dynamic UI, but at the moment, no one has registered, no one has filled in the sign-up sheets. So if in case no one will have done so, come Tuesday, Ren and I will discuss who will pick that topic to lead the discussion. So worry not. So we'll still meet next weekend. Okay, with that, if no comment, no question, I let you enjoy your weekend and have yourself a very awesome day, morning, or evening. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Lucy. Bye.
Great job.
Yeah, bye-bye.
Thank you. Yeah.